السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. I'm Ahmed Mustafa Abdul Rahman, Professor of Ophthalmology and Glaucoma Consultant, Cairo University, Egypt, and I'm very thankful for the kind invitation to participate in MIOC 2022. In the next few minutes, I'll be discussing issues related to examination of the angle of the eye, what's called gonioscopy. I have no financial issues related to my talk. A 65-year-old female presented with elevation of the intraocular pressure, 35 and 38 millimeter mercury without treatment, and fundus examination shows evidence of glaucomatous damage with retinal nerve fiber layer defects in both eyes, so that the clinical diagnosis of glaucoma is almost established. And before I proceed for further examination, I need to do examination of the angle of the eye, what's called as gonioscopy. The technique here is called the indirect gonioscopy because we use mirrors to see the opposite angle of the eye, and this is different from the direct gonioscopy, which is used basically for surgical purposes. The famous lens used is the three mirror, which is having a wide base, but it allows for stabilization of the globe during examination, and it needs a coupling medium. Other important lenses include the four mirror lenses, which are having narrow base, and they can allow for examination of the four sides of the angle without rotation of the lens, and importantly, can allow for corneal indentation. The famous lenses are Bossner and Sossmann lenses. During gonioscopy, I need to prepare my stuff, including the lens, the anesthesia, the coupling solution, and elbow rest is very important. I'll measure the intraocular pressure first, as I did, and I'll dim the room lights, and I'll reassure my patient all the time that it's painless and helpful for the decision making in her management. I'll ask the patient to look upwards, and then I'll apply the lens gently on the surface of the cornea after retracting the lower lid, and the lens is held between the thumb and index fingers. Again, reassurance all the time is very important. If I am using the three mirror and rotating the lens, or using the four mirrors, this is called the goniogram. And with the goniogram, it shows the four sides of the angle. I'm going to document all the information in the superior, inferior, temporal, and nasal angles. If on examination I get this view, this is an open angle where I can see all the details. So we can easily decide that this is an open angle glaucoma. And the features are like that. The Schwalbe's line anteriorly, and then comes the trabecular meshwork, and then the scleral spur and the ciliary body band. And to say this is an open angle glaucoma, I need to see clearly the scleral spur. The degree of pigmentation is variable. So this is an open angle too, and we can see the scleral spur, but the pigmentation is much less. The pigmentation varies in different quadrants, and being darkest inferior, and as we move towards the superior angle, the pigmentation is much less. The view is completely different from this angle where I don't see angle structures. So this is an angle closure glaucoma. By definition, angle closure is contact between the periphery of the iris and the trabecular meshwork for more than two quadrants or 180 degrees, and we can see the picture clearly here. This is another closed angle, and we can see peripheral anterior sinus. So to the left here is the picture of the open angle glaucoma where we can see all the angle structures, while with the angle closure glaucoma, we don't see anything, or maximally you can see the Schwalbe's line or parts of the trabecular meshwork. When it comes to angle closure glaucoma, we need to do some other further steps. Here is called the indentation gonioscopy. I'll apply gentle pressure on the cornea to push the lens back, and then I can get more details of the angle. This is helpful for the differentiation between synechial and appositional angle closure. Also, if I don't see angle structures, there is a technique which is called over the hill. I can slide my mirror towards the examined part of the angle, and I can get more details. Like here, I don't see details. If I just push the lens, slide the lens towards the examined part of the angle, I can get more details. The Schaefer and modified Schaefer angle grading system is an easy system. If we see the scleral spur, then the angle is an open angle, and if it is a grade 4, we see the ciliary body, definitely this is an angle of an open angle, and closure is very impossible. The Spaeth grading system gives further details, and it documents the appearance of the peripheral iris as well. Van Herrick is helpful, but it is not conclusive of the degree of the angle opening. So we need to do gonioscopy besides the Van Herrick method. The critical point is that when we decide that this patient is having an open or closed angle, the further management options are different, so that gonioscopy looks like a crossroad. If the patient is having an open angle, we will think of SLT and glaucoma operations beside the medications, while if the it's an angle closure glaucoma, we would think of peripheral iridotomy and phacoemulsification. A recent diagnosis of primary open angle glaucoma, and we opt for selective laser trabeculoplasty as recently published in the LIGHT study. In this case, we are going to use some indirect lenses also to see the angle, and the famous lenses are that Latina, Reach, and Magna, and they offer a magnified view of the angle, helpful for the treatment approaches. So here I'm using the Latina lens and I'm visualizing the trabecular meshwork, and then I'm applying the laser spots on the trabecular meshworks. Now, if a patient presented with glaucoma and the pressure is not controlled, we will proceed for trabeculectomy. But after surgery, sometimes the pressure goes up and we need to know what's going on. And in this situation, we can do gonioscopy and examine the ostium from inside and see if there is any tissue occluding the trabeculectomy site from inside. Also, one of the surgical approaches is to do deep sclerectomy by exposure of the trabecular meshwork and the peripheral Descemet's membrane, allowing percolation of aqueous. Sometimes the pressure goes up after the deep sclerectomy, and then we need to do a gonioscopy and we need to open the trabeculodescemet's window in a process called the goniopuncture using the YAG laser. So gonioscopy is very mandatory for this. Another case who presented with peaking of the pupil after goniopuncture. So what happened? That there is incarceration of the iris tissue at the site of the deep sclerectomy. Again, we will use YAG laser to retract this iris, and we will get then a rounded regular pupil, and the peaking is no more existing. Now think of this patient in the middle age and presenting with attacks of ocular pain and blurring vision upon doing exercise. He's having moderate myopia, minus 6 diopters in both eyes, and the pressure in one eye is 18 and the other is 26. Of course, there is a differential diagnosis, but again, the pigmentary glaucoma comes on the top, where we see Krukenberg spindles on the back of the cornea, and we need to confirm this by doing gonioscopy. Upon doing gonioscopy, you can see the heavy pigmentation of the trabecular meshwork and the concave pattern of the iris. So the diagnosis of a pigmentary glaucoma is established clinically even before investigations. But the situation is different here in this lady. She's presenting with pressure spikes, but actually the back of the cornea doesn't show pigments. So we need to do gonioscopy, and we were surprised that the angle is heavily pigmented, so that the Krukenberg spindles are lacking in 10 to 15% of the cases. So we need to go for gonioscopy to confirm our diagnosis. Again, a patient presenting with the elevation of the intraocular pressure, and he's giving a history of blunt trauma years ago. When we examine the angle, we will diagnose angle recession glaucoma. The diagnosis is not possible without gonioscopy. And this is another case. The patient was managed with cataract surgery because the lens was cataractous and insertion of a tube in the sulcus. If a baby is presenting with glaucoma and is having a primary congenital glaucoma or a PCG, we will anesthetize the baby and then we will examine the angle, and this is called direct gonioscopy at that time, and we can even go for surgical approaches including goniotomy and other surgical approaches. So this is called direct gonioscopy because we see the angle directly, which is helpful for the surgical approaches. The famous lenses are Swan, Jacob, Gonio Prism, Hoskins, Barkans, and Kobe. And again, the direct gonioscopy is a procedure helpful for the surgical approaches. So gonioscopy generally is a priceless procedure, which is helpful for the decision making. It's a crossroad actually in making decisions regarding the angle closure glaucoma and open angle glaucoma. The laser and surgical approaches, including the SLT and angle surgery, and complementary procedures like goniopunctures. And thank you very, very much.